iTunes. Hey, good morning, everybody.
Hello. Hey, Mrs. Doubtfire is joining us again today. Hello, everybody. Welcome aboard. Hey, hello to everybody in the chat. We've got some weather sharing, as we always do. So I'll do the weather report from here in Ottawa. It is a sunny day, hovering just below freezing, bright. And I can tell that the seasons are changing because I'm starting to get shafts of light coming through my office window, which means that soon I'm going to have to deal with that before every episode. For 6 months of the year, I get rays of sunshine blasting on me that I have to shield out when we go to do this in the morning. So it's a positive change.
We always say you're a ray of sunshine, Chris.
I'm confused. Which Chris are you referring to?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going to hop in on the ray. Center stage, right. The other Chris. Chris Karel. Yeah, I have to ask you, do I pronounce your name right when I say that? Is it Karel?
Yes. Karel? No, Karel is correct, yes.
Karel is correct. Okay, well, that's
Karel is correct. Sometimes during December, people call me Christmas Karel. That changes things for me. So, and I'm willing to deal with that.
A little bit.
I know of a fellow whose last name is Must and his first name is Christopher. When you shorten it, of course, he becomes Christmas.
Yeah.
Nice. So.
Anyway. All right. Since we broached the subject of Chris's, friends and family, we have Chris Karel with us here today, occupying the center square. Have we ever made a game show reference like that yet? Yeah. In the center square? Anyway.
I don't think so, because I think it's different for everybody.
Oh, okay. It shuffles. Well, from my perspective today, anyway. Chris Karel is joining with us here today. Chris, we'll give you a chance to introduce yourself. Tell the folks a little bit about yourself, where you come from.
Sure.
That kind of a thing.
Sure. Well, thanks for having me. As mentioned, my name is Chris Karel. I am a business owner. I own a business called Learning Carton, which is a video learning organization. I've been an instructional designer, a classroom teacher, a master's degree in education, and I've really spent the last 10 years or so working in video production, both on the marketing side and in the learning side, as well as managing the entire instructional design process from concept all the way to deliverable. And currently, I live in Lakewood, Ohio, on the beautiful north shores of Lake Erie. It's a sunny 32 degrees here. And there is no snow in sight because it's all melted away, but I'm sure that will change very, very soon. But I'm excited to be here and looking forward to the conversation, and can't wait to see what everybody in the chat has to bring to the table today.
Yeah, and it's been a little bit. Brent and I were noting earlier in the week and last week, et cetera, that it's been a while since we've talked about video. It's always cool to come back and circle back to it because it is such a powerful thing as a tool for us to be able to use in the e-learning biz. Let's sort of go back in time a little bit. How did you end up getting started originally in video? Like, where did that come from for you?
So I started in an education space, and I was always in love with computers. So when I was a classroom teacher, I always ran computer labs. I was always the person who came in when the IT person from the staff couldn't get there. And so that's always been a fascination with me, and I love film and cinema. I mean, you could probably see from some of my background items, I'm certainly a geek or a nerd. You apply the term, it doesn't matter to me. I love all of that stuff. So I've always been kind of fascinated with it. And as I had an opportunity to teach, I found myself in a position where I'm like, hey, I want to try to merge both worlds, my passion for education and learning into, video. And so, to fast forward a lot through my particular journey was I went back to school when the economy bottomed out, and got a degree, an entrepreneurial business degree, from a school that taught digital media. And so kind of learned professionally how to make video the way it's being made from agencies and film perspectives. And then ended up working in a space where both e-learning and video were big players. And so that sort of allowed me to sort of practice exactly what I was able to learn at university. And really found that what I love the most is the actual creating of the story that's in there and using the visuals to help make the learning way more interesting. And so for me, I realized, you know, that was my third degree, that, you know, you don't necessarily need all of those classes, all that big traditional education, or to get expertise in that. Really what you need is practice, and you need an environment that's comfortable for you. So I sort of got into it with the idea that I really needed a degree to go do that. And now I'm sort of saying, you do, but you sort of can do it right now with the way the resources are out there without having to go do a formal program. So,
yeah. And that's the really cool thing about where video is at, is, I mean, literally any one of us can pick up that thing out of our pocket and take some video. But maybe the challenge is moving from that to something that, first of all, has a little bit more of a professional quality to it, so it doesn't feel totally clumsy. That said, there's also an argument for authenticity that sometimes comes out of, you know, that kind of, that ability to just quickly snap and go or whatever. But then just being able, going from there and then being able to understand, oh, what are all the things that I can do with it when I put it into a software tool to add titles or to, you know, all those kinds of, all those various other things that end up spinning out. And it's, it can be, I think, a really kind of endless journey in discovering new things that way, because you see something on, you know, you're watching on a big screen at home on the, in the evening, and you go, ooh, how did they do that? So it's a neat space, because like you said, you know, you've got a formal background in it, but which you don't necessarily need, but I think it also helps you leapfrog some of that discovery, that slower discovery process too.
It definitely does. It definitely does. I think, you know, one of the things you brought up is something I try to sort of live in the conversation right now, Chris, which is, you know, everybody does have the ability to pull out their mobile phone and start making something, right? And that's different than when we were all probably fairly young. You know, if, you know, making film or video 20 years ago was nowhere near what it is now, right? But that doesn't necessarily mean that for learning purposes, that's a great thing, because like informal video or just homemade video that you sort of pull out and grab, that has its place in the learning environment, but maybe not for long-term, you know, engaging instruction where you need to be able to control it and modify it and edit it, because with that authenticity also comes sometimes shortcuts on professionalism, watchability starts to drop because the audio's bad, lighting's bad, those kind of things. And then the ability to modify it and turn it into other languages or add text, sometimes that falls apart with the cell video, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the things that you had noted as we were prepping, you know, for the session, is that there are still some aspects, I guess, of risk and challenges, you know, around video for training teams. So let's maybe talk about that for a little bit, and then we'll swing back to some of the things, because you've also got a couple of really cool, I'm going to call them tools, but by my mind, I'm saying toys, you know, that we can start talking about how we can, you know, start moving from that, that can help you start moving from that sort of, you know, cell phone alone into something else. So, you know, what are some of the challenges then that still face video being used in that you see in the in training programs, etc.?
So, you know, obviously, it's always a focus of cost, right? So, as soon as you start to talk about adding video to a project, sometimes it doubles the budget, right? And so, companies want video in their learning platforms and in their learning courses, because they know that their audience, the people who are their employees, they live and breathe video. It's becoming like our number one communication method, right? So all social medias are going that way. You know, there's 7 or 8 different streaming services that people probably have 3 or 4 of them that they're subscribed to. Like, video is just normal. Like, we're starting to communicate without phone, without talking or texting. We're just opening up a video chat, as we are doing now over the internet, you know, with our live broadcast. That's happening more and more. So people are sort of expecting that to be the norm. To get there from an L&D standpoint, though, you know, as instructional designers, we want to run through this process of like, well, we need to figure out why you need it to be there, and, you know, what are the learning objectives? And then before you know it, we've spent weeks, if not months, getting this course created. And then the video, depending on the topic, might either be outdated or might need to change. So the risk in rushing to create that is sacrificing a little bit of professionalism or a little bit of quality. And the reward sometimes in taking your time and maybe using informal video, like things made with a cell phone, but building it into a longer plan, is then you know that once you've spent the time putting it together, it's going to be effective. And so, again, I think the risks are, you know, can you make sure that it's going to be engaging? Or if you give over the creation power to just any employee, do you run the risk of somebody doing something either that will put the company at risk, or the quality is going to be poor? Or how do you handle, you know, Are they using their own phones, or are we now going to give them phones? Because some employees will be like, well, I'm not using my own personal phone to make something for the organization. Or, you know, does that mean that now you have access to all my data? If I have a data privacy right, you know, there's a ton of factors that are just starting to be talked about, you know, formally, with data privacy and access to content, through our cell phones that we've never really had to engage with before. So
it's interesting that you mentioned that, because I do hear that a lot. And sadly, I hear that used a lot as an excuse in larger companies, but I see so many smaller mid-sized companies that just aren't so worried about that kind of stuff. And the employees are motivated to do it. They want to add value to the company. That's why they're there. They feel like they need to share what they know, and they're a part of a community, the business, and they want the business to succeed as much as everybody else in the business. And so they're willing to use their own phone, or even on weekends, you know, videotape some cool stuff maybe, or on their lunch hour, create a cool little video and share it with their peers. Hey, what do you think of this? Hey, what do you think of that? You know, maybe we could do something like this. And everybody's doing really interesting experiments in those smaller businesses. But yeah, you're right. It gets very frustrating when I hear in the bigger companies all of the reasons why we can't do it, as opposed to why don't we just try?
Yeah, it's definitely a generational thing, Brent. What you're referring to is definitely generational. Like, even think of, you know, my kids who are in their 20s or early 20s right now. It's just normal. You expect to communicate and put that stuff out there. Like, they would do things and put it out where we would probably say, I don't know if I want that out there. And that's just kind of what young people do now. And it's not even a thought. Right. You know, there was sort of like a step in between there where people were worried about making quick videos and putting online because, well, it's out there forever and you'll never get a job. Well, obviously that's not true. That hasn't happened over the last 15, 20 years. I'm sure in some certain circumstances it has, but you know, it's become the norm that you put yourself out there, and that data is going to be shared, and you kind of go from there. Where the larger company gets involved, you know, a corporate client that I work with, where their biggest concern is, it's where the law gets involved, right? So you've got sanctions where data privacy has been breached or data has been shared that shouldn't be shared. There's $1 million sanctions applied to that company. Suddenly they're like what you just said, Brent. Hey, nobody's doing that anymore. Don't put any content on your phone. Don't use your phone, because now you're worried about something either proprietary to the organization or their clients getting out to just anybody. And that's where a bigger concern comes in, where like the use and the comfort of using a cell phone, your own personal phone for business becomes, you know, expensive.
So. You know, there's a couple of great questions in the chat. Laura asks, wondering how informal video works with accessibility requirements. And yeah, quite honestly, I'd never really thought of that, because I've always just kind of left accessibility up to the platforms, especially when I'm thinking about just kind of mobile informal stuff, right? Like, how does one with accessibility needs, I'll say, how do they watch regular videos on whatnot, you know?
So my experience in doing things that have to be compliant in that regard is providing a transcript. So maybe if it's a visual based thing and you need a screen reader to consume it, you'd have to have a transcript that goes along with it. So somebody who has the video come up, they can have some type of narration that's being played through their ears opposed to that. I imagine the same thing could be done with an informal video, but then who's doing that, right? Yeah. So if I just pull out my phone, or part of my project is to use the phone to capture something happening, who's going to go back and add it? My guess is the person making it probably is not going to do that. That's another step.
But I think a lot of that stuff going away too, right? All the automated systems out there that automatically make them. I mean, they're not perfect. We all know that. Right. But right. Nowadays, if you create a really informal video and you upload it to Google, right, it'll automatically translate it if you ask it to, and it'll create that. And I think Microsoft's product does that now too. And since Microsoft is the big corporate enterprise tool, what is it called? Microsoft Stream or something like that, or Microsoft, their video, it's like their YouTube for office.com. I can't think of the name of it now, but it launched a year or so ago, and it's only just started to have the caption stuff added. But anyways, I don't want to get us off down that rabbit hole, but
No, I think you're right, though. I mean, I've never played around with it because everything I've ever made, we do that as a part of it, right? So the transcription happens along with making the video and then adding the subtitles if it needs to be there. So that's, I've never trusted the AI, though. I would imagine it is happening. You know, people who are using YouTube for marketing, I see captions on that all the time, and they're just saying, I just flip on the auto caption, you know?
Yeah.
Again, that's sort of that dichotomy that I was sort of starting to set up with you, Chris, at the beginning is that, you know, video production is this thing that what most people think of as video production is not video for learning, right? It's video for entertainment or video for marketing and advertising. Even though some of the skills are the same, the purpose is very different, right? Yeah. You know, and so we have to remember that as we're creating this and rushing to this, we need to not necessarily say, no, we shouldn't do it. We should just make form. No. We need to find the skills and the model to apply it because we need to embrace that technology, but find a way to still deliver on the promise that we're going to, you know, improve knowledge or skills or behavior. That's the point of that learning video, not just to, like, you know, have this authentic, awesome capture of, like, Sharon showing you how to use the AR system. That's cool. But if that doesn't work for everybody, then we haven't really done our job as learning video creators, you know? So,
yeah, we had I did find quickly the Microsoft Stream info, which does have a closed caption option. So I threw a link in there. And a couple of other folks have thrown in some other services and stuff too, that anybody's interested, they can check those out. Here's a really cool question from, well, Thomas has got two questions in the official question and answer, and I'm going to go to the second one. First, he's asking Chris, and it's you, not me. Okay. Chris, is your project timeline similar with creating video learning to the traditional ISD project timeline, say for someone using ADDIE or some other model?
So I guess that depends. That's truly something that is situation by situation. I've been writing a lot lately and advocating that we modify our traditional video production process, you know. So in the beginning, that, you know, the five-stage process where we're at the beginning, where we're trying to develop what's going to go into the video, I think that needs to be a design phase, as opposed to, like, talking about what's going to be in the video as it relates to the visual assets, which is important. But I think the first step, and as instructional designers, this is a no-brainer. But the people who make video aren't always instructional designers. They're not always the folks who understand ADDIE or SAM or whatever model we're using to get to that end result, right? So yeah. I think from a production standpoint, I always say that can go as fast as the client's able to give us reviews, right? So having the tools available, whether we're using mobile or we're using a big professional setup, it's how fast can we turn around the production to get to that point of recording, right? Obviously, yeah. If it's desire to make something informally and make something quick, and we're putting the creation in the hands of the employee, that's different, right? That's very different than creating 5 or 6 courses to teach somebody something where we need to make sure that the video is timed perfectly with the learning objectives. So, you know, the tools can speed it up for sure, but I always pump the brakes along the way and say, let's make sure that this is going to work in the end and work for a long time, so that we don't rush too fast and then realize, hey, you know, we paid a bunch of money for that and it's worthless 6 months later. So.
Yeah, I think a lot of this, I noticed a lot of the questions and a lot of the comments in the chat, and we end up having these conversations around how do I get approval, right? And what's the formal process for doing it? And my favorite story that I used to share a long time ago when I would give presentations on this stuff, this was about 2010, I met one of the training guys at Guitar Center, and I think there's a new person there now I haven't been able to get a hold of, but I had him speak at an eLearning Guild event and tell his story about how he did this. And they just, everything internal, and they had packaging issues on shipping when have all the packages come right from the main warehouses. And so all he did was just have the people that were packing the stuff just use their camera or whatever and just, like, video one of the guys packing up how to do it correctly, just real quick, right off their mobile device. Even back then, the mobile devices they had, and they would just do a quick video of how to do it. The guy would talk through how to do it, boom, done. And then they would post it up to people for new hires. They would say, hey, you know, be sure if you're packing this, here's a new video of Dave, you know, doing the thing. And they had a whole bunch of videos. And I think what the point I've always tried to make with that is that a lot of this stuff, when we talk about informal video, right, it comes across, it's an either or, and I don't think it's an either or thing. It depends on the topic, right? And the context that you're going to be doing it. I think they were very safe in doing this particular, making this a solution to the problem because it was all internal. It was just for internal consumption. Hey, you know, if you're going to be packing this pallet full of boxes, you know, don't stack the tiny ones on the bottom and the big ones on top because it's unstable, you know, kind of things and all that. So what kind of like examples have you run into where you see people being successful with this or maybe unsuccessful?
So a couple of conversations I've had recently with organizations that are using software tools that allow for the use of like cell phone video, because it's so agile and in the hands of most everybody, is just like you described. So I need an expert to show me how to change some part that's in, you know, a plumbing closet or something like that. Or the reference I always used is somebody needs to show someone how to conduct some kind of process in a software tool for accounting and finance, right? So I have a friend who worked for a large bank who within their team, and this wasn't a formal process. It wasn't set up by L&D. It just sort of came out organically for them. They had an issue with a new software rollout and they got training that was probably designed by instructional designers. It was laid out for, you know, go through these steps and stages. And it was probably hours worth of training. That would be my guess. I don't know exactly, yeah. But it didn't work. Right? It didn't work because nobody watched it. They're like, I need to go and do this now. I don't have 3 hours to do it. I have to conduct the operation. So they just pulled out their phones and recorded them stepping through it. They didn't even use screencasting, just sort of held it with one hand and showed somebody, first you click this, then you click this, and they narrated it and then sent it to their team. So if that is not a definition of informal video learning, you know, because it's not really vetted, it's not controlled, there was no learning objectives laid out, there was no, you know, this is the business purpose and where we're going to get in the very end. But it was effective because it allowed somebody really fast to make that happen. Now, the question is, did the larger organization know that they were doing that? I don't know. Right. Have other organizations started to do that? Absolutely. Some tools have started to come in either through learning platforms or content management systems where it allows people to upload video to sort of make that happen. And, you know, some cautionary tales I've heard from other people that do that work all the time is that where that's most successful is where you have somebody that curates it, right? So that is somebody who's looking at that video as it gets posted and says, oh, okay, so Chris, who just made this video on how to move one document from AR to this other repository, that video is spot on. I'm moving that one up and I'm taking these other and flagging it to an archive so that when anybody goes looking for how to do that, they find the curated one that someone's vetted. So that's really effective, right? Because now you have somebody who has an understanding about what somebody should be doing. They're sort of playing that role of that designer up front, but after the fact, right? That curation is a key part in this because otherwise, you know, you could end up going into a place and like, how do you get there? You know, almost creating, if you're familiar with Reddit, an ability to like or to vote something up or vote something down, right? So if somebody goes in like, this is great, I'm voting it up. This is the one I want to see. You know, then you become this like audience-based score for whether or not the video has been relevant and helpful, you know?
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Thomas had another question in the chat as well. He said, you mentioned the university education that you got in this area. He said, was it a program that actually combined ISD, instructional design, and video training? Or tell us a little bit more about that program.
Sure. It did not. It was really a entrepreneurial art school. So the idea was for you to go in, learn the formal practices of art and design, and then sort of pick a focus. My focus was digital media, film and video, but I also learned how to do figure drawing and color theory and all the things that go into making you a good visual designer. And the fact of, you know, instructional design or the discipline of that, I got that earlier. Really in my master's education teaching and then, you know, teaching adults in that way. I used to lead teams of teachers in the schools that I worked in and taught some college courses. So I had that sort of adult theory before I came into that program. So I'm definitely a unique hybrid in that way, you know, in terms of my instruction. I didn't, like most people, I didn't go to school for instructional design, but my experience has led me to that and given me the skills that have allowed me to succeed in that world. So.
I just noticed Josephine's added a little Brent's smiling because he was thinking the same thing. the reference to the DJI Osmo, and let's move on to some simple things that we can add to our toolkit.
Josephine, time to get out, people.
I know, Josephine. It's like you're a mind reader, in some ways. So Chris actually has that exact tool, and he's going to show us a little bit about what it does. Like we were talking before, you know, I had even playing tourist and holding, you know, my phone in on a boat, trying to get a nice and how you get the wiggle, and no matter how perfect that sunset video with the birds flying by might be, it's all you know, spazzy and making us kind of seasick, etc. And that even applies on dry land, etc. So here's a tool that can help you with that kind of a thing, just to take that that idea of something fairly informal and yet give it a little bit more of a professional touch. Here.
Okay, so I have some tools to share with you. I was trying to pull up a little video clip while you were talking there, Chris. So this is to answer Josephine's question. So the DJI Osmo, this is the 2, the 3 is out now, and basically it operates like a Steadicam. So in the film world, there is a tool that you probably have seen either in sports or if you've watched any behind the scenes videos of people wearing this vest. It's got a heavy kind of counterweight system, and there's an arm that comes off of it, holds the camera, and then they grab it and they run around, and the camera sort of stays still and level as somebody moves. It's huge. I've used one of those in the school training that I went through. They are incredibly difficult to learn. People who run those, they are actually certified very much like you would be certified to use a specific type of equipment, because you have to train on it. You have to put in so many hours to enter the union to be able to run that thing. And let's just say it's not easy. I tried playing around with it and never could have much success with it. And they're expensive. I mean, hundreds of dollars for the vest, the extra add-ons that go with it are in the hundreds. You're probably in about $1,000 before you're even at a base level one. And I'm not talking like ESPN quality rig either. I'm talking about just prosumer. So this little tool here, the DJI Osmo 2, provides very much a similar experience and feel by sliding your cell phone into it. I'm not going to turn it on and power it, but essentially your phone slides in to this spot here. I'm trying to see my camera. So that when you're running it, it will create the exact same vibe and feel. And I'm going to see if I can share a screen here so you can kind of see what I'm talking about. Let's see if I can pull it up. Hopefully I can.
And most of the phones these days, I know the iPhones have a built-in sort of motion stabilization feature, but that's still not as good as using a external hardware device like the Osmo to get those balanced shots, especially if you're going handheld. You know, the alternative is a tripod, right? Taking that same sort of mobile phone grip and mounting your camera on a tripod and getting a really steady shot. But yeah, if you're on the go, you're not going to want to carry a tripod all over the place.
So can we see that?
Yep.
Okay. So this is using the DJI Osmo on the back of a sailboat that's bouncing around left and right. So you can see how crisp and clean this is as I go past the Sam Loud here on Lake Erie. So it's about as smooth as if I was carrying a rig or using a drone, and that is literally my cell phone and on the DJI Osmo. So let's see if I can click the
It's a little stuttery just because you're trying to play the video and stream it, but idea. Mm-hmm.
So, and you know, the other thing that I recommend along with this, so this, you know, this tool can take the place of getting nice steady movement shots if you have to do somebody walking towards you, or if you have to follow behind somebody to help, or even if you're just recording an operation that someone's conducting either with tools or, you know, being able to move and maneuver the camera around with it is great. But that's just the motion control, right? So that gives you that smooth, easy motion. You always want to make sure the other two pieces that kind of come with that is good lighting, which I'm not going to flip around. I do have a light up here, but this little guy here, is a Rode microphone, and it plugs right into my cell phone to provide a shotgun mic experience using the mic as opposed to the onboard mic for the phone. So if you record audio using your microphone on your phone, even though they've gotten better, it'll sound more hollow. There'll be a lot more noise because the attenuator inside of your phone is constantly trying to level it to a bass level, whereas this focuses the sound gathering to one spot wherever you point it. I'm not going to try to demo that over internet because it'll be even worse than the stuttering video just because of the feedback and the noise you'll get. But I can definitely honestly say that the purchasing this tool, pointing it on here, and using it for anything for recording, even for home use, it's a night and day difference between the quality.
What model is that? Did we mention that?
So I pulled up a little tool I can show you. This is the Rode VideoMic Mi L directional microphone for iOS devices. So good news for Android users, it's a little bit cheaper if you buy the Android version. The Lightning version is $79. I think the Android's about $59. And sometimes the ones for iOS are a little harder to find. Like I purchased that B&H Photo. No affiliation once again, just they're a great place. They have good help. They can provide good customer service for you if you have questions about stuff. But when I went to buy mine, they did not have them at Amazon, only at B&H.
It looks like the Osmo 3, even their newest version, is around $100. If you buy one of the fancy kits that people have pre-created on Amazon, you can spend anywhere from $120 to $140, it looks like, to get a whole bunch of other cool accessories with it too.
It's funny that you should mention that, Brent. So this is the kit that I got with my Osmo. And I would say this, as I was telling Chris earlier, this is probably one of the greatest pieces that came with it. So mine was around 100 something, maybe 120 when I bought it a year or two ago before the 3 was out. And it's just nice to have this black case that you can close everything up. It has a handle. It's pretty durable. I've taken it on planes. It takes a good shock because of the foam. And it also comes with this little guy, the squirrel, which is super valuable, especially if you're doing anything outdoors. The squirrel fits, you like that, it comes with the squirrel, maybe I've broken Brent. So the squirrel goes inside or covers your microphone, right? So it fits inside there and it'll provide a little bit of wind shear, which is incredibly valuable if you're shooting outside. If you've ever been outside trying to shoot anything or any kind of place where there's some wind movement, it'll pick up on the shotgun mic, but yeah,
I think some of you may have seen me at events mounting this on top of my iPhone on a handheld rig, and I use this for like just mobile interviews and stuff like that, and it kind of functions the same way. Haven't pulled it out in a long time actually because my new iPhone, haven't quite been able to figure out how to get the connector to work correctly in the new adapter, and there's all sorts of weird technical things. I think there's an official adapter that I could buy from Rode. I just haven't done it yet. To be honest, microphones these days, I mean, you get fairly decent audio off of an iPhone, you know? So as long as we're talking informal and quick and just trying to, get some video and get an image done, most of the devices these days, even the other phones, I'm trying to come Android phones, right? and the Samsungs, and all that. They even have great software and audio pickup and mics, and most of the manufacturers are really focused on making that image capture experience really, really, really high quality. So you don't really have to go with those adapters too much. But to your point, if you want to level up your game, then having the extra stuff to help keep the wind noise down, focus audio, all that kind of stuff is fantastic.
Yeah, I know some folks that have done a lot of content marketing using just their phone with no add-ons. And I watch it, you know, I'm sure if you go on LinkedIn and watch video, most of the videos that people are making, they're either holding their phone to make a selfie, right? Or they're setting it down somewhere and recording. And the audio is pretty good. And especially if the folks are doing it in a place that's quiet. Right. So in a business setting, you rarely ever can find a really quiet space. And so that little directional add-on certainly cuts out a lot of ambient noise because it focuses just on that one spot. But you're absolutely right. Depending on your purpose, Brent, you can pull off most with just the phone and without the add-ons. But, you know, as someone who makes professional video and does that, I listen to it. I'm just like, I'm already broken. And I know I'm not the only one. Right. Because the audio or bad lighting, or you know, our shaky camera will distract you from what's happening, right? So
right. We've got an old episode. One of our old, I had a friend of mine that I met a long time ago at one of the guild events. Now his name's escaping me. But I was super shocked. He made a boatload of money off of art videos online, and we were talking about video, but video for learning and how do you figure stuff out. I can't remember exactly what our topic was. I think we were all over the place, but he made all of his videos that he sold online and made a ton of money doing it just by mounting an iPhone on a thing, no external mics, nothing at all, pointed it at a blank paint canvas, had an artist just start painting, and he would sell it, you know. And I remember thinking to myself how blown away I was when I, you know, he's like, yeah, no, we didn't worry too much about, you know, getting a professional crew or anything like that. We didn't want to invest the money. We just wanted to try it just to see if people really wanted to see this kind of stuff. Once we saw that people loved it and didn't care, we just kept shooting it that way.
Yeah. And Shannon's got a really good point. People will watch a bad video all day, but we'll turn it off in a second if it has poor audio, which is why I have internet issues in my rural home, and watching in, you know, different services, the video might go chunky, square and gray, but they're always working super hard to at least make sure that you can still hear the audio piece clear as a bell. They might downgrade the video portion, but yeah, the minute you can't hear what's going on, you know, you're going to bail. Yeah,
for sure. Audio is critical. Everybody says that. You won't get an argument from any AV person. Audio is number one, they say. So it is definitely something to think about, but there is also, I saw some conversation earlier about this, where a lot of people today, and there's even data that supports it, watch online videos with the sound turned off. Mm-hmm. You know? And so at that point, then, you know, you've got to have that, you have to have some good visuals to keep people engaged. There's just so many different ways to create video. I just love having these conversations because it's become just so ubiquitous and so easily accessible. And there's there's still a need. Let's also just get this out on the table too. There is absolutely still a need for professionally done, professionally scripted, professional crews that know what in the heck they're doing and creating really good quality video for your training. You know, there's no other way around it. But it's just like you don't need a professional writer to write an email if you're just trying to, you know, say something to somebody. You know, if you can write, you can write an email and send it out. Nowadays, video, kind of the same way. If you want to share a visual image of what you're trying to do and you want to teach somebody, capture it on video and share it with them. You don't have to be a pro. But then if you want to polish it up and go up a few levels, then you might want to think about getting some pros out there because there's some good reasons to use it. But it's an interesting conversation for sure.
Well, like so many things, it is a spectrum of opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Yeah.
All right.
I really think if I could say one more thing about that, Brent and Chris, is I think that the key is for me especially, and what I try to share with other people, is to be open to the prospect and the idea of doing it, right? And be willing to learn the new technology. I think what we face a lot in the L&D space is, well, we've always kind of done it this way, and now we got to use video. So then we ended up adding video to it, and really we've just made a PowerPoint with video, right? We haven't really used the tool for what it was intended. And so being able to sort of be an advisor and a consultant to folks and say, you know, let's look at how people are using video in your company and how we can use that to help create learning experiences, as opposed to forcing video into an old model, right, or the way video is being used into an old model that doesn't really work it with people today, right? Remember, like, most people are watching, you know, hours and hours of streams of video a week, a day, right? People are on their phones constantly. You know, all the stats that I'm sure everyone has read over the last number of years is that, you know, we're in the 70 to 80% range for, like, the traffic that's in the internet. So finding a way to embrace what's coming and use it for learning purposes. That's what we should be focused on doing, and not trying to say, well, it needs to be done this way. We need a full crew and we need to spend, you know, tens of thousands of dollars, or we can do it the other way, which is like, let's just pull out the phones and just start making it. Like, there's got to be somewhere in between. And that's where, like, our roles as instructional designers is to come and say, okay, we should definitely do that informally, but how can we shape it in a way that's going to be successful in the long run? How is it going to be tied to our business purpose, right? That's really our job, is to embrace the technology that's coming and sort of help people get there with the tool that's necessary. So,
yeah. I think Thomas leaves us with a fabulous statement to close out our show for today. He says he saw a Word graphic a couple days ago that read, "Video is the new text." And I would completely agree. I was actually going to tell a story early on when we got to that point, similar to that phrase. But Thomas, thank you for dropping that in there, because it is true. For sure. Hey, did we get all the links dropped in and everything for you, Chris, so people know how to reach you? Because I'm sure a lot of folks in the chat could use a little consulting and a little conversation with professionals that know what they're doing and actually enjoy doing this on a regular basis.
I dropped the links in there as we were talking about the two products that I showed. Awesome. And I'm not advocating that you buy them from those two places by any measure. It's just a Google search for me. I draw my email into the chat there, and then my company website is in there as well. I do publish content each week. That's going to be this ebook that's going to lead 6 months out about video for learning. I'm sort of waffling back and forth between, do you really need that formal education for video, or can you learn from experts online yourself? And that ultimately comes down to the learner, right? Like, so me, I needed to go somewhere. If I was going to do it at home, those video streams for HBO Go and Netflix and everything else was going to draw me away from learning on my own. Getting to a classroom and interacting with people was successful for me, but that's not always the case for everybody. So, so that's rolling.
And within the same frame, don't let that be a barrier to actually getting started and trying some of these things. Because until you start finding the things that you don't know what you don't know. Or do you know what I mean?
I think, yeah, one of our other previous guests, you know, he has the phrase that pays, right? The just press the damn button, right, it is what he says. He's actually got a book coming out soon about this kind of stuff. He's a marketing guy, but, you know, same concept applies. If you want to learn this stuff, there's nothing scarier than pushing that big red record button on there. But, and you know, you got to get past it. So just press it. You can always delete, right, and just get comfortable pressing that button and recording stuff and figuring it out. You never know until you try.
Yeah, very cool. All right, I think it's time to dance on out of here. Brent, if you've got the music handy.
There it is. I hope everybody has a fantastic day, Chris. Thanks for hanging out with us and being our guest today. It's been awesome.
Yeah, I'm going to argue that trumpets are the new text.
And fair enough, on the special effects too.
Oh yes, nice ring halo on that from the lighting there.
That's right.
I didn't even use a DJI Osmo.
No, you didn't. That was good, smooth. That was well rehearsed.
Yeah,
you have good training. Good training somewhere, Brett.
Practice makes perfect. So long, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.